and welcome to my first video coming back to YouTube. Today we'll be reviewing the Planet of the Apes films from 1968 through 1973 and the reboot of 2001. Let's get it started right off the bat with Planet of the Apes 1968. Astronauts Taylor, Landon, and Dodge awaken from deep hibernation after a near-light-speed space voyage. Stewart, the lone female crew member, is dead due to a sleep chamber malfunction. Their spacecraft crashes into a lake on an unknown planet, and the men abandon the sinking vessel. Before bailing out, Taylor reads the ship's chronometer as November 25th, 3978, 2006 years after their departure in 1972. The men travel through desolate wasteland, coming across eerie scarecrow-like figures and a freshwater lake with lush vegetation. While swimming, the men's clothes are stolen and shredded by primitive mute humans. Soon after, armed gorillas raid a cornfield where the humans are gathering food. Taylor is shot in the throat as he and the others are captured. Dodge is killed and Landon rendered unconscious in the chaos. Taylor is taken to Ape City, where two chimpanzees, animal psychologist Zira and surgeon Galen, save his life, though his throat injury renders him temporarily mute. Taylor is placed with a captive female who he later names Nova. He observes an advanced society of talking apes with a strict caste system. Gorillas are the military force and laborers. Orangutans oversee government and religion, and intellectual chimpanzees are mostly scientists and doctors. The ape society is a theocracy, while the apes consider the primitive humans as vermin to be hunted and either killed outright, enslaved, or used in scientific experiments. Taylor convinces Zira and her fiancé, Cornelius, that he is as intelligent as they are, one way, by making a paper airplane. Dr. Zaius, their orangutan superior, arranges for Taylor to be castrated against Zira's protests. Taylor escapes and finds Dodge's stuffed corpse on display in a museum. He is soon recaptured, in the process of revealing that he can speak, which alarms the apes. A hearing to determine Taylor's origins is convened. Taylor mentions his two comrades, learning that Landon was lobotomized and rendered catatonic. Believing Taylor is from an unknown human tribe beyond their borders, Zaius privately threatens to castrate and lobotomize Taylor for refusing to reveal his origins. With help from Zira's nephew, Lucius, Zira and Cornelius free Taylor and Nova and take them to the Forbidden Zone, a taboo region outside of Ape City, where Taylor's ship crashed. Ape law has ruled the area out of bounds for centuries. Cornelius and Zira are intent to gather proof of an earlier non-simian civilization, which Cornelius discovered a year earlier, to be cleared of heresy. Taylor focuses on proving he comes from a different planet. When the group arrives at the cave, Cornelius is intercepted by Zaius and his soldiers. Taylor holds them off by threatening to shoot Zaius, who agrees to enter the cave to disprove their theories. Inside, Cornelius displays remnants of a technologically advanced human society predating simian history. Taylor identifies artifacts such as dentures, eyeglasses, a heart valve, and to the ape's astonishment, a child's talking doll. Zaius admits he's always known about the ancient human civilization. Taylor wants to search for answers, ignoring Zaius's warning he may find an answer he does not like, and that what is now a desert was once a paradise. After Taylor and Nova are allowed to leave, Zaius has the cave sealed off to destroy the evidence while charging Zira, Cornelius, and Lucius with heresy. Taylor and Nova follow the shoreline on horseback and eventually discover the remnants of the Statue of Liberty, revealing that this alien planet was actually Earth long after an apocalyptic nuclear war. Understanding Zaius's earlier warning, Taylor falls to his knees in despair and condemns humanity for destroying the world as Nova looks on in confusion. So I found this to be an entertaining sci-fi film with a unique concept that holds up despite its age. The ape costumes were pretty good, except that they don't fully close when they speak, and some of the actors' voices were muffled. My biggest issue, though, was that the story didn't quite feel complete, and there are some outdated tropes and characterizations, such as female characters being generally sidelined and underused. Specifically, there are four female characters. One of them dies off quickly. One of them is mute and doesn't speak. One of them screams when they see a human. And the fourth one is Zero, which I felt was my favorite character of the entire film. And the sole black character died pretty early. That was another issue I found with the trope that was overused. My favorite shot of the movie, however, was the see no evil, hear no evil, and speak no evil, which was actually improvised. So that was pretty fun fact that I found out. Now let's move on to Beneath the Planet of the Apes. Following the events of Planet of the Apes, time-displaced astronaut Taylor and the mute Nova ride horseback through the desert of the Forbidden Zone in search of a new life far away from Ape City. Without warning, fire shoots up from the ground and deep chasms open. Confused by the strange phenomenon, Taylor investigates a cliff wall and disappears through it before Nova's eyes. The phenomenon disappears, leaving Nova alone. Elsewhere in the Forbidden Zone, a second Earth spaceship has crash-landed after being sent to search for Taylor and his crew. Brent and his skipper are the only survivors, though the skipper dies shortly after crashing. Brent, while noting he's in the year 3955, assumes he has traveled to another planet. After burying his skipper, he encounters Nova and notices she is wearing Taylor's dog tags. Hoping Taylor is still alive, he rides with her to Ape City, where he is shocked to discover the simian civilization. He observes the guerrilla general Ursus leading a rally for the apes to conquer the Forbidden Zone and use it as a potential food source against the objections of the orangutan Dr. Zaius. Brent is wounded by a gorilla soldier and taken by Nova to the home of the chimpanzees Cornelius and Zira, who treat his wound and tell him of their time with Taylor. Attempting to flee the city, Brent and Nova are captured by gorillas. Ursus orders they be used for target practice, but Zira helps them escape. They hide in a cave, which Brent soon discovers is the ruins of the Queensboro Plaza station of the New York City subway, realizing he's traveled through time to Earth's post-apocalyptic future. After following a humming sound deeper into the tunnels, Brent becomes agitated and erratic and attempts to drown Nova as she drinks, quickly stopping and backing away to another room. Entering the remains of St. Patrick's Cathedral, he finds a population of telepathic humans who worship an ancient nuclear bomb. Brent and Nova are captured and telepathically interrogated by the telepath's leadership under Mendez. They explain themselves to be the descendants of humans who survived nuclear holocaust and mutated over generations. While claiming to be a peaceful society despite using mind control and illusion on their enemies, the mutants force Brent into revealing the apes' march on the Forbidden Zone. But their attempts to repel the invaders with illusions of fire and other horrors ultimately fail when Zaius sees through it. With the apes closing in, the telepaths plan to detonate their divine bomb as a last resort, holding a righteous ritual during which they remove their human-skinned masks to reveal their mutated pale skin with prominent large veins due to a generations of radiation exposure. Brent is separated from Nova and taken to a cell where he finds Taylor, the mutant Ongaro, explaining that they cannot let them leave the city alive, uses his telepathic powers to force Brent and Taylor to fight each other. Nova escapes her guard and runs to the cell, screaming her first word, Taylor. This breaks Ongaro's concentration, freeing Brent and Taylor from his control long enough for them to overpower and kill the mutant. Brent describes the bomb the mutants worship that to have Greek letters Alpha and Omega on its casing, Taylor recognizing it as a doomsday bomb capable of destroying the entire planet. The apes invade the subterranean city, making their way to the cathedral. Many of the mutants are either captured, killed, or found to have died by suicide. After Nova is killed in the midst of the chaos, Taylor and Brent reach the cathedral as Mendez is shot dead after raising the bomb into activation position. The humans attempt to stop Ursus from accidentally setting off the weapon, but Taylor is shot as his pleas to Zaius fall on deaf ears. When Brent is gunned down after killing Ursus, the mortally wounded Taylor curses Zaius as he collapses and dies, bringing his hand down on the activation switch, triggering the bomb. The scene whites out, and voiceover narration states, "In one of the countless billions of galaxies in the universe lies a medium-sized star, and one of its satellites, a green and insignificant planet, is now dead." Now, before I start, you may have noticed a continuity error, since the first film states that they're in 3978, while this one says they're in 3955. Now, let's get into the proper review. For the longest time while watching the movie, I was wondering why the creative team felt the need to introduce the character of Brent, since he looked and sounded acted exactly like Taylor. I later found out it's because Charles Heston wasn't interested and only agreed to shoot a few scenes. If I had made the movie, I would have just recast the role, since I had a difficulty telling the difference between the two actors. However, this is the least of the movie's problems, since much of the first half retreads the first film. I also thought that the visual effects, most of them, were pretty terrible, but luckily they weren't used too often. The only thing I can say this movie did surprisingly well is the ending, although it is pretty abrupt and anticlimactic, in my opinion. Now let's move on to the third film in the set, Escape from the Planet of the Apes. During the events of the preceding film, Beneath the Planet of the Apes, occurring off-screen, Cornelius and Zira escaped Earth prior to its destruction when they accompanied their fellow chimpanzee, Dr. Milo, in salvaging and repairing the spaceship originally used by Taylor. The shock wave of Earth's destruction sends the ship through a time warp that brings the apes to 1973 Earth, splashing down off the Pacific coast of the United States. The apes are transported to a secluded ward in the Los Angeles Zoo under the observation of scientists Dr. Stephanie Branton and Dr. Lewis Dixon. With Dr. Milo explaining their situation in private, the apes decide not to let the humans know that they can speak while agreeing not to reveal Earth's destruction from the ape war. However, Zira's impatience exposes the apes' power of speech during an experiment, and Dr. Milo is killed moments later by a zoo gorilla who became agitated by the chimpanzee's argument. Lewis tries to communicate with the apes, and he is peaceful, and he wishes to treat them as equal, winning their friendship as a result. A presidential commission is formed to investigate the return of Taylor's spaceship and determine how atypically intelligent apes came to be aboard it. The apes are brought before the commission, where they publicly reveal their ability to speak. The council asks them about Taylor, but Cornelius and Zira tell them that they know nothing about him. They reveal that they came from the future and escaped Earth when war broke out. They are welcomed as guests of the government. Cornelius and Zira secretly tell Stephanie and Lewis that they did know about Taylor, explain how humans are treated in the ape-dominated future, and about the Earth's destruction. Stephanie and Lewis are shocked, but still sympathetic, the latter advising the couple to keep this information secret until they can gauge the potential reaction of their hosts. The apes become celebrities and are lavished with gifts and media attention. They come to the attention of the president's science advisor, Dr. Otto Haslein, who discovers Zira is pregnant. Fearing for the future of the human race, he offers her Grape Juice Plus, for which she has developed a taste, to loosen her inhibitions and question her further while recording it. Her candid responses enable him to convince the commission that Cornelius and Zira must be subjected to more rigorous questioning. Haslein insists that he simply wants to know how apes became dominant over men. Cornelius reveals that the human race will cause its own downfall and become dominated by simians, and that simian aggression against humans will lead to Earth's destruction by a weapon made by humans. Zira explains that the gorillas started the war and the orangutans supported the gorillas, but the chimpanzees had nothing to do with it. Haslein suspects that the apes are not speaking the whole truth. During the original hearing, Zira had accidentally revealed that she dissected humans in the course of her work. Haslein orders Lewis to administer a truth serum to her while Cornelius is confined elsewhere. Lewis assures Zira that the serum will have the same effect as Grape Juice Plus. As the result of this serum, Hasline learns details about Zira's examination and experiments of humans, along with her knowledge of Taylor. Zira joins Cornelius in confinement while Hasline takes his findings to the president, who reluctantly must abide by the council's ruling to have Zira's pregnancy be terminated and that both apes be sterilized. In their chambers, Cornelius labels Hasline and the others savages for Zira's treatment, as she reminds Cornelius that she did the same thing to humans and Taylor called them savages. Zira is relieved to have revealed the truth because she is tired of lying. Cornelius fears that the truth will get them killed. When an orderly arrives to offer the apes food, his playful reference to their unborn child as a little monkey makes Cornelius lose his temper and he knocks the orderly to the floor before escaping with Zira. Cornelius assumes he merely knocked out the orderly, but he is actually dead. Hasline uses the tragedy in support of his claim that the apes are a threat, and it calls for their execution, but is ordered by the president to bring them in alive, as he will not endorse punishment for the orderly's death until due process has been served. Branton and Dixon help the apes to escape, taking them to a circus run by Signor Armando, where an ape named Heloise has just given birth. Zira gives birth to a son, whom she names Milo, in honor of their deceased friend. When Hasline, knowing that Zira's labor was imminent, orders a search of all circuses and zoos, Armando insists the apes leave for their safety. Lewis arranges for the apes to hide out in the shipyard in the Los Angeles harbor until the coast is clear to return to the circus as it heads to Florida, giving Cornelius a pistol as the couple do not want to be taken alive. Hasline tracks the apes to the shipping yard and mortally wounds Zira while she refuses to hand over the infant, firing several shots into the infant before being killed by Cornelius. Cornelius is shot by a sniper and falls. Zira, tossing the dead baby over the side and crawling to die with her husband, witnessed by a grieving Lewis and Stephanie. As Armando's circus prepares to leave Florida, it is revealed that Zira switched babies with Heloise prior to leaving the circus and that Armando is aware of this. Milo begins to talk. This one, more than Beneath the Planet of the Apes, although it still didn't live up to the original. I found this movie more comedic in the first half, with the second half delving into humanity's fear of the unknown and potential future. The ending is also better than the previous installment, as it didn't feel as abrupt and felt more in line with the original. Some qualms I have to mention is that I believe they should have gone with Brent's ship rather than Taylor's, since I find it hard to believe that they could find and fish it out. I also thought that Cornelius would have enjoyed going to the Museum of History instead of Disney's Jungle Cruise ride, since he is an architect, but I understood why it was written that way, because if they had written it differently, where he was going to the Museum of History, Zira would not have been drugged and revealed anything to Hasline. Now let's move on to the fourth film, Conquest of the Planet of the Apes. North America, 1991. Following a pandemic from a space-borne disease that wiped out all dogs and cats in 1983, the government has become a series of police states that took apes as pets before establishing a culture based on ape slave labor. These events were foretold in 1973 as testimony by two chimpanzee scientists, Cornelius, prior to his wife, Zira, being killed. While it appears their baby was also killed, he evaded death and was secretly raised by the circus owner Armando. Now fully grown and named Caesar, Armando brings him to one of the cities to distribute flyers for the circus's arrival, explaining to the curious ape that events that led to their new reality, while advising him not to speak in public for fear of his life. seeing apes performing various menial tasks and shocked by the harsh abuse inflicted by rebellious apes, Caesar shouts, "Lousy human bastards!" after seeing a gorilla messenger being beaten and drugged. Though Armando takes responsibility for the exclamation while defusing the situation, Caesar runs away in the commotion. Finding Caesar hidden in the stairway, Armando tells the ape that he will turn himself in to the authorities and bluff his way out, while instructing Caesar to hide among a group of arriving apes for safety. Caesar follows Armando's instruction and hides in a cage of orangutans, finding himself being trained for slavery through violent conditioning. Caesar is then sold at auction to Governor Breck, allowed by his owner to name himself by randomly pointing to a word in a book handed to him. The chimpanzee's finger rests upon the name Caesar, feigning coincidence. Caesar is then put to work by Breck's chief aide, McDonald, whose African-American heritage allows him to sympathize with the apes to the thinly veiled disgust of his boss. Meanwhile, Armando is being interrogated by Inspector Culp, who suspects his circus ape is the child of the two talking apes from the future. Culp's assistant puts Armando under a machine, the Authenticator, that psychologically forces people to be truthful. After admitting he has heard the name Cornelius before, Armando realizes he cannot fight the machine and jumps through a window to his death after a brief struggle with the guard. When Caesar learns of the circus owner's death, he loses faith in human kindness and begins secretly teaching the apes combat while having them gather weapons. By that time, through Culp's investigation, that the vessel which supposedly delivered Caesar in from a region with no native chimpanzees, Breck learns that Caesar is the ape they are hunting. Caesar reveals himself to McDonald after he covered for the ape twice when called by Breck on Caesar's whereabouts. While McDonald understands Caesar's intent to depose Breck, he expresses his doubts about the revolution's effectiveness, along with Caesar being dismissive of most humans. Caesar is later captured by Breck's men and is electrically tortured into speaking. Hearing him speak, Breck orders Caesar's immediate death. Caesar survives his execution because McDonald secretly disables the machine's electrical output. Once Breck leaves, Caesar kills his torturer and escapes. Caesar begins his revolution by first taking over ape management to build his numbers, proceeding to the command center of the apes, killing most of the riot police that attempt to stop them, while setting the city on fire after bursting into Breck's command post and killing most of his personnel. Caesar has Breck marched out to be executed. McDonald attempts to plea Caesar not to succumb to brutality and be merciful to the former masters. Caesar ignores him in rage and declares,
"Where there is fire, there is smoke. In that smoke, from this day forward, my people will crouch and conspire and plot and plan for the inevitable day of man's downfall, the day when he finally and self-destructively turns his weapons against his own kind, the day of the writing in the sky, when your cities lie buried under radioactive rubble, when the sea is a dead sea and the land is a wasteland, out of which I will lead my people from their captivity, and we shall build our own cities in which there will be no place for humans except to serve our ends, and we shall found our own armies, our own religion, our own dynasty, and that day is upon you now."
The theatrical cut of the movie, as the apes raise their rifles to beat Breck to death, Caesar's girlfriend, Lisa, voices her objection, shouting no. She is the first ape to speak other than Caesar. Caesar reconsiders and orders the apes to lower their weapons, saying,
"But now we will put away our hatred. Now we will put down our weapons. We have passed through the night of the fires. And those who were our masters are now our servants. And we, who are not human, can afford to be humane. Destiny is the will of God. And if it is man's destiny to be dominated, it is God's will that he be dominated with compassion and understanding. So, cast out your vengeance. Tonight, we have seen the birth of the planet of the apes.
So, in the extended cut, they don't stop and they do kill Breck. That's the only difference. So, while it can be heavy-handed in its messaging, it is the most entertaining of the Planet of the Apes sequels, and I felt it rivaled the original. I found the relationship between Caesar and Milo, Caesar, Milo, and Armando to be quite compelling. I also appreciated the character of Malcolm McDonald and thought his ending speech was quite poignant. I saw both endings and surprisingly felt that either of them worked. They could have explored the subtext of human workers that enslaved apes have displaced protesting for their jobs back further. I thought they could somewhat relay the plot line as automation replacing entry-level jobs like cashiers and waiters and soon-to-be maybe drivers with self-driving cars. However, my biggest complaint is that the music I felt was overdone and distracted from what was going on screen, especially during the revolution. Overall, I would recommend this film, even if you would likely need to watch all the other two sequels to understand everything. Now let's move on to the fifth film of this series, Battle for the Planet of the Apes. Told as a flashback to the early 21st century with a wraparound sequence narrated by orangutan lawgiver in North America 2670 AD, this sequel follows the chimpanzee Caesar years after a global nuclear war has destroyed human civilization. Living with his wife Lisa and their son Cornelius, Caesar creates a new society while trying to cultivate peace between the apes and remaining humans. Caesar is opposed by an aggressive guerrilla general named Aldo, who wants to imprison the humans who freely roam Ape City while doing menial labor. After defusing followers of Aldo who attacked a human teacher for saying no to apes, Caesar ponders if his own parents could have taught him how to make things better. McDonald, Caesar's human assistant, and the younger brother of McDonald from the previous film, reveals that his brother, Caesar, or reveals to Caesar that his brother told him of archived footage of Cornelius and Zira within the underground, now radioactive ruins of what is known as the Forbidden City from the last film. Caesar travels with McDonald and his orangutan advisor, Virgil, to the Forbidden City to find the archives. It is revealed that mutated and radiation-scarred humans are living within the city, under the command of Governor Culp, the man who once captured Caesar. Caesar and his party view the recordings of his parents, learning about the future and Earth's eventual destruction before they are forced to flee when Culp's soldiers hunt them. Fearing the mutant humans may attack Ape City, Caesar reports his discoveries. When Caesar calls McDonald and the select group of humans to the meeting, Aldo disagrees with the human presence and leads the guerrillas away. Culp's scouts find Ape City, believing Caesar is planning to finish off all mutant humans. Culp declares war on Ape City despite his assistant Mendez's attempt to get him to see reason. Aldo plots a coup d'etat in order for the guerrillas to take control. Cornelius overhears from a nearby tree, but is critically wounded when Aldo spots him and hacks off the branch of a tree he is on with his sword. The next day, after a guerrilla scouting pair is attacked by Culp's men, Aldo takes advantage of a grieving Caesar's absence to have all the humans corralled while looting the armory. Cornelius eventually dies from his wounds, leaving a devastated Caesar when the revelation that Cornelius was not hurt by humans. When Culp's ragtag force launches their attack, Caesar orders the defenders to fall back. Finding Caesar lying among dozens of fallen apes, Culp expresses his intention to personally kill him. The apes, however, are merely feigning death and launch a counterattack that captures much of the mutant humans. And his remaining forces try to escape, only to be slaughtered by Aldo's troops once they are out in the open. Aldo confronts Caesar about releasing the corralled local humans and orders the guerrillas to kill them. When Caesar shields the humans and Aldo threatens him, Virgil, having learned the truth from MacDonald, reveals Aldo's role in Cornelius' death. Enraged with Aldo for breaking their most sacred law, all the apes chant, "Ape has killed ape!" An infuriated Caesar pursues Aldo up a large tree. Their confrontation results in Aldo falling to his death. With Caesar realizing that apes are no different than their former human slave owners, as Aldo proved, he agrees to MacDonald's request for humans to be treated as equals, coexisting in a new society. They store their guns in the armory. Caesar and Virgil reluctantly explain to the armory's overseer, an orangutan named Mandimus, that they will still need their weapons for future conflicts and can only wait for the day when they will no longer need them. The scene returns to the lawgiver saying that it has now been over 600 years since Caesar's death. His audience is revealed to be a group of young humans and apes, the lawgiver noting that their society still waits for a day when their world is no longer in need of weapons, while they wait with hope. A close-up of a statue of Caesar shows a single tear falling from one eye. So this movie began with a 4-minute recap of the previous two movies for a movie that's less than 90 minutes long, which is generally a bad sign for me if you need to recap the previous installments to extend your runtime. I felt that this movie was made as an epilogue and didn't have much interesting to say. I also have a few nitpicks with things that the movie does with characters or plot points. First, when they're in the archive room watching Zira and Cornelius' speeches, I don't think those conversations were filmed. Instead, they were only voice recordings. Secondly, I found that Culp was a dumb guy. He decided to leave a desolate wasteland and wants to make what could become his paradise another wasteland? It makes no sense. Instead, what he should have been thinking about is eliminating all the apes, or enslaving all the apes again, although that probably wouldn't work, and taking over the land. Not that I would condone those actions. But it would make a smarter plan for the villain. Cornelius II should have also phrased himself better rather than having his father play the pronoun game during his death sequence, saying, "Aldo hurt me," instead of "they hurt me." Overall, Conquest of the Planet of the Apes was a better ending to the series, and I would probably recommend ending there rather than checking this one out. It would have been a much better story if they had focused more on the struggles of developing a shared and peaceful society. Now let's move on to the reboot that was done by Tim Burton in 2001. In 2029, aboard the United States Air Force space station Oberon, Leo Davidson works closely with apes who are trained for space missions. His favorite ape co-worker is a chimpanzee named Pericles. With a deadly electromagnetic storm approaching the station, a small space pod piloted by Pericles is used to probe the storm. Pericles' pod heads into the storm and disappears. Leo takes a second pod and finds Pericles. Entering the storm, Leo loses contact with the Oberon and in 5021 AD crashes on a planet called Ashlar. He learns that the world is ruled by humanoid apes who speak English. use domesticated horses for transportation, and treat human beings as slaves. Leo meets a female chimpanzee named Ari, who protests the mistreatment of humans receive. Ari decides to buy Leo and a female slave named Dana to have them work as servants in a house of her father, Senator Sandar. Leo escapes his cage and frees other humans. Limbo, an orangutan trader of encaptured humans, sees them but is taken prisoner to ensure his silence. The murderous General Thade and his junior Colonel Attar march ape warriors to pursue the humans. Leo discovers Kalima, the forbidden but holy temple of Samos, the first human whom the apes revere as a god. Kalima turns out to be the remains of the Oberon, which has crashed on the planet's surface and now looks ancient, the name Kalima coming from the sign Caution Live Animals, the relevant letters being the only ones not covered in dust. According to the computer logs, the station has been there for thousands of years. Leo deduces that when he enters the vortex, he was pushed forward in time, while the Oberon searching for him was not, crashing on the planet long before he did. The Oberon's log revealed that the apes on board, led by Seamus, organized a mutiny and took over the vessel after it crashed. The humans and ape survivors of the struggle left the ship, and their descendants are the people Leo has encountered since landing. The apes arrive and attack the humans who have gathered to see Leo, although he is able to even the odds when he uses the Oberon's last fragments of fuel to fire a final blast at the first wave, of apes. The battle stops when the familiar vehicle descends from the sky, which Leo immediately identifies as the pod piloted by Pericles, the chimpanzee astronaut who was pushed forward in time as Leo was, and has just now found his way to the planet. The electromagnetic storm actually releasing people from it in an opposite direction in time to their entrance. When Pericles lands and the pod opens, the apes bow, interpreting his arrival as the return of Seamus. The hostilities between humans and apes suddenly cease. Pericles runs into the wreck of the Oberon, and Leo runs after him, followed by General Thade. Thade and Leo fight. Pericles tries to help Leo, but Thade throws him hard against a wall. Thade takes Leo's gun from him and tries to fire it at Leo. Leo sees that Thade is within the pilot's deck and closes the automatic door, trapping Thade inside. Thade fires the gun repeatedly at the door, but the ricochets create sparks that scare Thade, who huddles under a control panel. Deciding to escape Ashlar and return to Earth, Leo gives Pericles to Ari, who promises to look after him. After saying farewell to Ari and Dana, Leo climbs aboard Pericles' undamaged pod and travels back in time through the electromagnetic storm and crashes into Washington, D.C. on Earth. He looks up at what appears to be the Lincoln Memorial, only to find that it is now a monument memorializing General Thade. A swarm of police officers, firefighters, and news reporters, all of whom are apes, descend upon him. So while the makeup and prosthetics are much better than the originals, the story itself feels like it took a jumble of ideas from those five films and mashed them all together, leaving an uninteresting mess. The production design is okay at best, and not much better than the originals. The actors would sometimes mumble or whisper their lines, making it hard to know what they're saying, and the characters are all fairly one-dimensional. I appreciate that the ape actors moved more ape-like than the ones in the original and the sequels, although I recognize that the original film had the actors were part of more of a advanced ape society, but even in like Conquest, they were acting, they should have been acting more primitive than they were. But this one, they did act very much like apes. The ending made absolutely no sense. The fuel cells were depleted, and it's unknown how General Thade would have gone back so much earlier than Leo. I would estimate, like, at least 200 years. But I am glad that Tim Burton didn't just make an updated version or an exact copy of the original film, like many other remakes of classic films today. Now let's move on to my ranking of the series of films, starting with, at the bottom, with Planet of the Apes 2001, which I rated a 1.5 out of 5. Next on the list was Battle of the, for the Planet of the Apes at 2 out of 5. Then Beneath the Planet of the Apes at 2.5 out of 5. Escape from the Planet of the Apes was number 3 at 3 out of 5. Then at number 2 is Conquest of the Planet of the Apes at 3.5 out of 5. And number 1 is the original film, Planet of the Apes, 1968, at 3.5 out of 5. I really had a tough time determining which of the top two I would put, because I think both of them are really great. I almost can put them as a tie, but I decided that the original is better than the fourth one. Now, for the next video, I will be doing a Spike Lee director watch through. I'll be splitting that into three parts. So stay tuned for that, and I hope you enjoyed the video. Please like, comment, and subscribe. Give me your suggestions for anything you want, because I know I need to improve, and I hope to improve as videos go on. Thank you for watching. Have a great day.